Hey, welcome to the orchard. I'm glad you're with us this morning. Can you believe this? It's been a full year, 52 weeks, that we have been recording and presenting our online worship services. Who would have thought back in March 2020 that we would be here doing this today? Hey, I'm grateful that we're meeting in person. That's wonderful. And I'm so, so thankful that we've been able to meet online over these weeks. But I tell you what, this has been a wild ride, hasn't it? One thing that has been so helpful for me, I hope it's true of you as well, is that being able to worship Jesus, coming before the throne of God, pouring out my heart, worshiping Him, praying, praising, giving myself back to Him, it has made for me all the difference. I hope that's true of you as well. So join us in worship this morning. Brian and Tess, thank you so much for leading us now. And brothers and sisters in Christ, let's worship our Jesus. Please worship with me.
Yes, and Let's hear these words now from Psalm 19, which is the selection of the Lenten psalm for this week. The words are, "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the expanse proclaims the work of his hands. Day after day they pour out speech. Night after night they communicate knowledge. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are reliable and altogether righteous. They are more desirable than gold, than an abundance of pure gold, and sweeter than honey dripping from a honeycomb." Let's join with all creation in praising our God, who is glorious, whose word is true, and whose love endures forever. Alleluia.
Lives and pleads for me. and tells me of the guilt within. Upward I look and see him there, who made an end of all my sin.
Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. To look on him and pardon me. Behold him there, the risen Lamb, my perfect spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood, my life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my God. I bow before the cross of Christ, I marvel at this love divine. God's perfect Son was sacrificed to make me righteous in God's eyes. This river's depths I cannot know, but I can glory in its flood. The Lord Most High has bowed down low and poured on me his glorious love, and poured on me his glorious love, and poured on me his glorious love.
We begin our time together today acknowledging that it's been about a year, a little more than a year, since the words COVID and coronavirus and pandemic became part of our daily conversation. And in these 12 months that have followed, there has been so much that has happened, so much about which we have prayed, so much about which we have come before God with our hearts and said, Father, Father, please help, help, help. And so I think it's appropriate for us today in our time of prayer to reflect on the fact that God has been faithful to us. God has been merciful to us. He has been gracious to us in so many ways. I am grateful for the opportunity to come before him in prayer this morning. I also want to acknowledge that these days have been, for some of us, for many of us, in our families, in our close friends, days of deep, deep loss and grieving. Family members who have been lost to COVID, circumstances that have kept us from being with family, people in the hospital and not being able to go and care for them and be with them. The reality of this, it weighs heavy on us even today. So I'm going to invite us as we pray to come before God our Father, who knows these things, who is with us in these realities, and to come before him with praise and with our prayer requests. So join me now as we pray. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come before you as we do moment by moment, day by day. And we bring before you those needs within our lives because you've told us to. But Father, I first want to begin by offering praise to you this morning, to praise you and to thank you, to lift not only my hand but my voice in prayer and to praise you, Heavenly Father, for the great mercy and grace that you have given to us, for the love that you have poured out over us, for the goodness you continue to show to us. And so, Father, we thank you. Lord, I pray especially for fellow followers of Jesus in our church who have experienced loss this year. loss in such a way that has caused them to grieve deeply. Holy Spirit, meet them there in those moments of grief, those days, weeks, months of grief. Be with them, Father, I pray. Father, even today we lift up families we're aware of whose loved ones are battling COVID. And so, Father, we pray for your healing hand of mercy over them, your wisdom, your strength, your courage for those who are coming alongside and caring for them. And Father, give to them what they need. Oh, Father God, our hearts are broken by the realities that have been upon us in these 12 months. And yet our hearts are strengthened by you as well. So, Father, be for us this day what we need. Thank you that you've called us to be your children. Father, we come before you, we lift up to you the life of the Orchard. We're grateful for the fellowship that we are, fellow followers of you, following after you. There are so many things that join us together, that bring our life together in you into focus. But Lord, I pray that these words we're about to say and pray will bring us even closer to you and to each other. So, Father, hear now these words taught to us by your Son, Jesus. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Now let me bring to your attention some great activities that are coming in the life of the Orchard in the days to come. For our family ministry, Orchard Kidz, there's going to be an opportunity online, even this morning, in a couple of times in a month, there'll be a worship video, an interactive video, where you can sing some songs, you can learn some lessons, you can just have fun together. And I'm grateful for Katie Rao and Jackson Scoward putting that together for us. That's wonderful. Still having kids' time on Sunday mornings during the online worship services. But this worship video, this Orchard Kidz opportunity is just an extra benefit for you as families. And kids, I hope you enjoy that greatly. And children of the Orchard, hey, come March 27th in the morning, 10 to noon, we're going to be having an Easter egg hunt here on our property. And so I encourage you, go to our website. You'll find more information there, orchardnh.org, and you can get ready to come, find some fun items here as we do an Easter egg hunt. That's always a great time, a lot of fun. So invite your friends and your family, come along and be a part of that. That weekend following Easter weekend, throughout the week, we will be having worship services Monday, Thursday in the evening at 7 p.m., an in-person worship service that Pastor Ryan will be leading, a Good Friday online service that Pastor Kevin will be leading, and then for Easter weekend, Saturday and Sunday, four services on Easter weekend, Saturday night at 5 p.m., and then three services on Sunday morning, 7, 9, and 11. All of these services you have to register for. You have to, for the in-person services, you have to register for them. Again, go to our website, orchardnh.org. You'll find the information there. And I greatly encourage you, plan on being a part of the body of Christ, Orchard Christian Fellowship. Be a part of what God is doing in our community, and come join us, please. You know, the life of the Orchard, it really depends upon the contributions that we receive. And so I encourage you, please continue to give faithfully and graciously, generously to Life of the Orchard. You'll see an opportunity there on our webpage in order to do that. And for those people who are coming to our in-person worship services, again, I encourage you to come prepared to give a gift. It's important. Thank you. Now it's kids' time. Pastor Ryan has a word for our kids. So kids, come join Pastor Ryan as he teaches you now. Thank you so much.
Good morning, kids. Come down for kids' time. You know, I do have a question for you. How many of you have heard this or have said this? And your parents might be able to answer this as well. Get your hands off that. Stop it. That is so annoying. Give that back to me. It's mine. Go away. Mom, Dad, my brother, he is bothering me. I'm sure we've all heard that, right? You've heard that. Maybe you're riding in the car with your brother or sister. Maybe one of your friends, maybe one of your classmates is bothering you or you're bothering them. Believe me, kids, as you get to be adults, the same thing continues. We as human beings, we often are not at peace with one another. There are times when we get into arguments or at times we get into little fights or skirmishes, and the fights get pretty big too as you become adults. But one thing that we are told and we're promised is that God gives us peace and he helps us to be at peace with others. Let me demonstrate with this visual. This is a cross. The cross is how God made peace with us. Jesus died for our sins. Our sins separated us from God. We were away from God. But when Jesus died for our sins, we then became at peace with God when we trusted in Jesus. And so I like the cross because what it does is it demonstrates vertically, the up and down, of how God has peace with us. We're unholy and we're sinful, and God is holy and he makes peace with us through Jesus. But then also, he makes it possible horizontally, side to side, for us to be at peace with our brother and sister, with our classmates, with our parents, with other people. He gives us peace, and he gives us peace through his Holy Spirit. I'll show you another example here. This is something we have at our home, and it has the visual of the Holy Spirit is a dove, and it has all these words in different languages, Latin and English, and the Jewish language Shalom, which means peace. The Holy Spirit is what God gives you and gives me, so that we might have peace with other people, and God has made it so that we would love other people and be at peace with them. But that can be kind of hard. So one thing I'll encourage kids for you to do when you're riding in the back seat and your brother and sister are bothering you, or maybe you're just disagreeing, you're disagreeable, you're having a bad day, to say this prayer, to pray this prayer. Lord, let me be at peace with myself, with you, and with others. Let that be your prayer, and God will help you. Let's pray. Lord, let me be at peace with myself, with you, and with others. Through Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Good morning, Orchard. Well, we continue in our study of the Gospel of Mark, and we now turn to a familiar passage, Mark chapter 11, 1 through 11. This passage is, of course, replicated in different ways through the other Gospels. It is the story of Jesus's triumphal procession to Jerusalem. We commonly use this passage on Palm Sunday. So it may seem kind of awkward that we are reading this passage and studying it a few weeks before Palm Sunday. But perhaps today, there might be more clarity that's provided because we're doing it somewhat off our normal schedule. That maybe because we're not waving around palm branches or palm leaves, or we're not folding them into a shape of a cross, that maybe we see different things in this passage today. And that is my prayer, and that is our hope today. So hear then what Holy Scripture says. You'll find it on the screen, and you'll find it in your Bibles, Mark chapter 11, 1 through 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you why you're doing this, tell him, 'The Lord needs it, and we'll send it back here shortly.'" They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, "What are you doing, untying the colt?" They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David! Hosanna in the highest!" Jesus entered Jerusalem and went to the temple. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. Loved ones, all flesh is like the grass. The grass withers and fades away, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Let us pray. Oh, Father, we pray that you would conduct within us the divine dialogue in which you would use the words of a mere individual such as myself, that you would transform it into our hearts and minds, that we might be all the more led by your Spirit, closer followers of Jesus, and aware fully of his amazing grace in our lives. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, the King. Amen. There's one day in my life that I will never forget. And so for many of you who've experienced the same thing, you too will never forget. The day of my wedding, September 16th, 2006. It was a sunny day in Wethersfield, Connecticut. The service was at the First Church of Wethersfield, a 17th century built church, famous church. Jonathan Edwards preached there. There was a lot of services that had gone on there. It was a traditional colonial setting of much preparation. We decorated the inside of the sanctuary with flowers and preparations. We had an organist play. There was a giant pipe organ that was there, and we wanted to play some classic hymns. There's nothing like hearing classic hymns on a pipe organ. And as I came out to the altar with the pastor and the groomsmen, the wedding march was playing in full volume, reverberating inside the building. The glassware that was probably just as old as the building was shaking. Everybody was moved. You can see it in people's faces, the magnificence of the event, the transcendence that was felt in this building. And the way it was structured, the church, was that, you know, the altar was sort of in the center of the sanctuary, the center, not at the front, but at the center. And so the people who would come in through a side door. And so as my to-be wife, Amy, and her father would enter in, they would enter through the side, go around the back where everyone was, and then turn and come towards me and the pastor at the altar. And so as she would come in, there was notifications being shared with the organist, and the organist started playing louder and crescendoing. And she was coming around, and coming around to the center aisle, she stopped with her father. And then the cue came. in which two of the groomsmen, my brother-in-law and my friend Matt, would go to the back and they would unroll this runner. It was like a carpet, a fabric that they would unroll and roll down the aisle so that my wife and her father would proceed on this runner. The funny thing is, as that was happening, they were trying to unroll it, and it got stuck, and they were kept struggling with it. It was for a few seconds, and people were like, okay, what's going to happen here? This music is playing, it's crescendo, but this runner is kind of stopping everything. And my brother-in-law, Steve, without any hesitation, pulls out this Crocodile Dundee knife out of his pocket, and everybody's like, it's like a hunting knife, and he cuts the thing, and we're all wondering, well, what else is he concealing in his pockets? But anyway, he cuts the thing, and they roll it out, the wedding proceeds, the music is magnificent. I remember the pastor, after our wedding, comes up to us in the hallway, and he's just like beaming. And he says, "You two are glorious. The Lord is glorious. That was glorious." The word he kept saying was glorious and glorious and glorious. And my friend who blogged about this, he was a blogger at the time, my friend, one of my best men at the time, he said, "I went to a worship service and a wedding showed up. Our goal for the whole service was to make it magnificent to the glory of God. It was shown in the music and the decorations and how we proceeded and the songs that we sung and the commitments we made, of course." I relate that a little bit to this passage today. That Jesus was coming and this was a glorious event. This was a triumph. It's labeled in your text, if you read your Bible, say triumphal entry. I see it more as a triumphal procession, a triumphal announcement by Jesus, a triumphal welcome. He's coming down the Mountain of Olives, and he is the Prince of Peace. So, the points I want to get across today is that Jesus is the King of glory predicted, and he shows himself deliberately as such. And that the people give him a kingly welcome. But yet, or however, Jesus' mission is one of peace and submission. And thus, that's what we walk as well as followers of Jesus. So let's dive into the text. The text itself is rich with Old Testament symbols, Old Testament allusions that I'll try to draw out. May this be a meal for us as we're consuming the Bible today. It says, as they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives. See, Bethany and Bethphage were two towns or two hamlets on the road to Jerusalem. So you picture the Mount of Olives here on the east, Jerusalem 300 feet below the Mount of Olives, and Bethany was on the southeast side, and then there was a road that led up. Bethphage was a village closer to Jerusalem, and then Jerusalem. And so Jesus started in Bethany. That's where he was. He was presumably with Mary and Martha and Lazarus, who he just rose from the dead. And so he had a great swell of people who were interested in Jesus already preceding that. We see that in Mark's gospel. We see that in Luke's gospel, how the crowds were swelling so much so that when they were in Jericho, for instance, which was many miles away, you know, Zacchaeus had to climb a tree to see Jesus. The crowds were swelling, and they were swelling because they were curious about this person who raised Lazarus from the dead. So you have a great crowd already there. You had Jesus coming from Bethany, and here's the other pieces that come into this puzzle. This was during the time of Passover. We know this to be a week before Jesus rose from the dead. And so this was the time of Passover. You had pilgrims coming from all over the land, all over the world. Some from Cyrene, as we read in Scripture. Up to 2 million people were in Jerusalem or in its surrounding vicinity. And Passover was a time of religious expectation. It was a religious holiday in which the Jews, as we know from the book of Exodus, they recall back of the story in which they were redeemed and rescued from bondage out of Egypt. And so you would think that they would have that kind of thinking in Jesus' day as well, because Jerusalem and Israel were under, they would think, bondage. They were under bondage from the Assyrian attacks, from the Babylonians, and then the Greeks. And then now, in Jesus' day, the Romans. The Romans were the occupying force, and the Jews wanted them out. They come to celebrate Passover, but they had this nationalistic fervor. Sounds familiar. But they had this nationalistic fervor to restore Israel back to the way it was. Nearly 200 years earlier, they had some success in doing that. Antiochus Epiphanes, who was a Greek leader, captured Jerusalem, and he sought to stamp out the Jewish religion and in favor of Greek culture, Greek language, Greek religion. He set up sacrifices in the temple to Zeus and other Greek gods, and in some rooms in the temple, he turned into brothels. So in response, the Jews rose up and drove him out at the leadership of Judas Maccabees and his brother, Maccabeus and his brothers, to rescue their native land. And ultimately they did. Jerusalem was retaken and the temple was rededicated. And here's what's captured in some writings about this conquering of the Maccabees. Therefore, it says, they bare branches and their fair boughs and palms too, and sang psalms unto him that had given them good success in cleansing his place. So there's precedence here of people expecting great things, that someone would come and rescue Israel. Now, regarding the Mount of Olives, I think there's some good context here. It's 300 feet higher than the temple, higher than Jerusalem, and it overlooked the Kidron Valley. Just as you would enter into a city, you're driving down 93 south and you go around a corner and then you see the Boston skyline. Such was the case. There was a turn on the Mount of Olives where as you're proceeding down, you see Jerusalem and the surrounding area. But what's important about Mount of Olives, which is neat, is that back in 586 BC, when the Babylonians overtook Jerusalem and Judah, Ezekiel had this vision in chapter 11 of his book. He says, then the cherubim with the wheels beside them spread their wings, and the glory of the Lord of Israel was above them. The glory of the Lord went up from within the city and stopped above the mountain east of it. Ezekiel was prophesying God's judgment upon his people in Jerusalem. And that the temple, the glory of the Lord left the temple. This is a sign of judgment. Whenever the glory of the Lord leaves, it's a sign of judgment. It left the temple and proceeded eastward and descended down upon the east mountain, Mount of Olives. So you see that. The glory of the Lord now descending on the Mount of Olives. And then comes Jesus. And where does he come from? He comes from the east, descending into Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives. Jesus, who is the exact radiance of the glory of God, says the author of Hebrews. He is the image of the invisible God, says Paul. And John writes in his gospel, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling, pitched his tent, tabernacled, was a temple among us, he says. And we have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only, who came from the Father full of grace and truth. You see, Jesus became flesh and tabernacled with us, and the glory of the Lord is now descending from the Mount of Olives, returning back to Jerusalem. What a neat thing. Jesus deliberately presents himself as the King of Glory predicted. He tells his disciples now, go ahead, and as you enter the village ahead of you, which presumably is Bethphage, you will find a colt tied there, colt or a young donkey, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you why you're doing this, say, the Lord needs it and we'll send it back here shortly. And so they did the same. They did exactly what the Lord had told them to do. Now, recently, Amy and I went to a laundromat. And usually we do our laundry at home, but if we have these big quilts, big giant blankets, you can't wash that very effectively, and perhaps you'll break the machine or break the quilt. So we went to a laundromat. Anyway, as we were leaving in mid-cycle between wash and drying, there was a woman who ran into the laundromat, presumably to change over her stuff, put it into the dry cycle or whatever. She left her car running, and it was like right in front of the entrance to the laundromat, and it was a brand new BMW crossover vehicle with a new car smell and everything. The door was wide open. She had some small radio playing. And I was thinking to Amy, I said, want to go for a ride? Now, I was just kidding. However, the thought came to my mind as I was looking at this passage thinking, well, what if I did take it for a ride, go around the parking lot there in Merrimack, and then the police apprehended me, you know, had me in handcuffs, and asked, you know, what was going through your mind? I would say, well, the Lord had need of it. Or if the lady stopped me and said, what are you doing? The Lord needs it. I don't think that would fly too well. What I think Jesus did here was he deliberately set this up, that he probably had friends in the community. He's been in Bethany and Bethphage for a while. He probably had a friend who had a donkey. He had a young donkey. So he probably worked out the arrangement to which the disciples would have a password that they would use when they go there. You know, they're untying the colt, they're untying the young donkey, and someone would ask them and say, oh yeah, the Lord has need of it. And then, oh yeah, yeah, that's right, Jesus. Either way, let's think about this donkey for a minute and the significance of it. It was never ridden. That's an indication of the holiness of this very instrument that would carry the Lord. There's Old Testament significance of articles that are used in the temple that are never used for secular purposes but are set aside for sacred purposes for the holiness of God. Those, the instruments that carried the Ark of the Covenant, are one example in 2 Samuel. And also there's cows and heifers that were offered that were never used before except to be offered as sacrifices. How fitting that an unbroken animal that's sacred would carry the unblemished, spotless Lamb of God. This animal was a short animal too. It says in Matthew's gospel, it's the foal of a donkey. It's a young donkey. It's like a child donkey. Unused before, never out in farming, unused, never ridden before. Now, donkeys in the Middle East were quite short. They're shorter than what we imagine as donkeys over here in North America. And so the way I picture it is, have you ever, as a young parent, for those of you who are parents, ridden your child's first bicycle? Like getting on your child's bicycle, and you're trying to prevent your knees from hitting your chin, but also you're trying to prevent your feet from touching the ground. And I do that just to test the air in the tires, because if it can hold up me, it can definitely keep my children intact. Well, that's kind of the way I picture Jesus riding this donkey. He's keeping his feet up in the air as he's riding this young, unused donkey. But the significance of this is it's a messianic proclamation. It is Jesus declaring to the world, I am the one who has come. I am the king. Genesis 49 speaks of the lion from the tribe of Judah, whose scepter will not depart from him. And it speaks of him having a donkey that's tethered. Zechariah chapter 9 says this, rejoice greatly, daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will take away the chariots from Ephraim, the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. And so the disciples and the people recognize what Jesus is proclaiming here. Jesus is saying, I am the one who's come. I am the descendant of David. I am the one who is promised. I am the one in which you are to rejoice. And so the people give him a kingly welcome, as do the disciples. They lay down garments before him. This was done to Jehu when he was anointed king over Israel in 2 Kings. The people laid down garments before him, their cloaks for him to walk over. And the same is true for Jesus. They recognized him as king, and so they laid down their garments before him, and they waved branches. And we see in the Gospel of John that these branches were palm branches. They gathered branches from the fields and brought them out and waved them. Palm branches representing victory, victory, victory. Revelation chapter 7, if you want to go there at some point, you'll notice that the great multitude whom Jesus has redeemed are clothed in white, washed clean, and they're waving their palm branches in victory because the Lamb of God who was slain has rescued them, has redeemed them, and they have victory. And what do these people shout? They shout the great Psalm 118, the Hallel Psalm. They say, Hosanna, save now. That's what they're saying. Save now. This crowd of people. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. This is the pilgrim psalm. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming of our father David. Hosanna in the highest. Here comes this king. He's riding on a donkey. He's not walking now. He's riding on a donkey. And shouts of praise would reverberate. At which point the religious leaders told Jesus to rebuke your disciples. To which he said, if they were silent, even the stones would cry out. You see, the people in the surrounding community, the people who came out, however many people came out to proclaim and say Hosanna, they got the story right about his messianic fulfillment, that he is indeed the descendant of David. Their expectation was for Jesus to rule, to make things right. Was he the next one who would come, just as Maccabeus did, he would do to the Romans what Maccabeus did to the Seleucids, the Greeks? Likely, however, they only saw Jesus with one eye open. Jesus would indeed be the great king and Messiah, but he was not after an office of king of Israel. He was not threatening to overthrow Caesar. His kingdom objective was to restore worship in spirit and in truth. His kingdom objective was to seek and to save those who are lost. His kingdom objective, he says earlier in the Gospel of Mark, is not to be served, not to lord it over people as the Gentiles do, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom payment for the many. His mission was of peace and submission. He demonstrates this by riding on a donkey. He wasn't riding on a battle horse. He demonstrates this that he weeps over Jerusalem, saying that they could have peace if only they knew it, but their hearts are hardened. His mission was to give his life, to offer himself as the temple of the Lord, as the holy unblemished lamb, as a sacrifice so that people would come to know God and have peace with God. He came with the intent of peace. Surely there would be people who would reject him and not be at peace with him. But his intent was to bring peace between God and man. Surely, yes, Jesus is the Son of Man who would ascend the throne at the Ancient of Days. He would be the one who would sit at God's right hand and have his enemies as a footstool for his feet. But that was not this time. That's the future. That is what we are hoping and expecting on the last day. But right now, Jesus came in peace. Right now, in this moment, and in these moments that we live now, Jesus comes. It's the year of the Lord's favor. He said to his disciples that he would be a suffering servant, not just the reigning Son of Man. He would be the suffering servant. He says, we are going up to Jerusalem. Look at him. He's just focused on Jerusalem. We're going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the teachers of the law. They will condemn him to death and will hand him over to the Gentiles, who will mock him and spit on him, flog him and kill him. 3 days later, he will rise. Jesus was to give his life as a ransom for the many. He was to be the suffering servant of peace, and that's what he did. Surely he took up our pain, says Isaiah, and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. And the punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Jesus came with the purpose to give his life. And through Christ alone, yes, that is where we have peace. That was his mission. And that is our mission. Though Jerusalem would reject him, many would come to receive him. Though people had expectations of this king on one day shouting Hosanna, there would indeed be those same people saying, crucify him. Yet Jesus came to seek and save. That was his mission. His kingdom was not a nation-building exercise, was not some restoration or some amendment, not some insurrection, but his kingdom would be established through peace, a spiritual kingdom. The last verse of this passage, I think, is kind of quiet, but it speaks so loudly. It says, Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything, and since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. So he just went in. He had this triumphal procession. He enters in through the east gate of Jerusalem, and it's seemingly quiet. Where did everybody go? I'm sure he gave the donkey back at this point, but it's quiet. He's going to the temple. He's looking around. He's observing. It's already late, so probably people have already shut down their money-changing stations. Everybody left, maybe. There's not too many people left in there. It's quiet. They're dimming things down. The sun's going down. I wonder what he was thinking. What was he thinking? You know, what, did he see the tables and weights and think about that? Did he consider the destruction of the temple, the judgment of the temple? Did he consider what he would say to them the next day where he says, destroy this temple and I'll raise it again in 3 days? Was he angry? How did he sleep that night when he went back to Bethany? I've always been told that you don't make quick decisions at night. You don't make decisions when you're tired. And you certainly don't post anything on Facebook when you're tired at night. But Jesus, did he sleep that night? Did he reflect on what he had to do? The temple was eerily quiet. No one recognized Jesus for who he really was once he was in the temple. The loud hosannas grew deaf. And there was a hardness of heart in Jerusalem. But Jesus came to bring peace. And his peace would be accomplished through his suffering. And that is what he would endure. He came to proclaim peace through the giving of his life and his blood. And we too follow in his footsteps. And there's application here for us, threefold. The first is that we follow in his steps as peacemakers. This is the year of the Lord's favor. He went in peace to give himself and submission. And that is the way we approach it as well. As we go out, as we meet with our coworkers and our family members, we are approaching them in the peace of Christ, declaring who he is and that God has reconciled people to himself through Jesus Christ. That is the gospel. It is his cross work. It is what we declare. We're not after mixing Jesus into political movements, okay? We're not doing the same thing that the people did when they greeted him as he was descending down the Mount of Olives, expecting some national Messiah. We do this all the time as an evangelical church. Every 2 years, every 4 years, it's like a broken record. Let's have prayer tours on behalf of the nation. Let's restore the United States to the way it always was. No, that's not the mission of the church, folks. That's not my mission. That's not your mission. Our mission is to tell of Jesus. Tell of his goodness and his grace and mercy and his work on the cross for sinners. For you and me. He has made us peacemakers. Paul writes, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone, the new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sin against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, as Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us, we implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us so that we in him might become the righteousness of God. We are peacemakers. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the sons and daughters of God. Second point of application is this. This is the year of the Lord's favor. if you're watching this, if someone invited you to watch this online message, this online service, to be a part of it, if you're watching this from afar, I know there are people across the country who may be tuning in, and you're seeing this, hear that the Lord is welcoming you into relationship with Him. He comes in peace. He's given Himself for you. This is the year of the Lord's favor for you to turn your life over to Him and to be saved. To cry out to God, to cry out to Jesus, Hosanna, save now. Save me. Third point of application, which will be highlighted in the song that you'll hear after this message by Tess and Brian, is that there's hope. That even as we live through these times now that are hard, and we know that we're peacemakers, but it's hard, and we're hit with all the travails of life and the suffering that we endure, Jesus will make all things right. He is the Messiah. He is the Son of Man. He will come again in glory. And He is with you right now through the peace of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, Hosanna. Thank you that you came to save me, to save us, to restore us so that we may worship you in spirit and in truth. As we enter into the song of reflection, and as we celebrate the new covenant through the Lord's Supper, help us all the more to be wrapped in your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
It's an honor to be able to share a special song selection with you this morning. We're preparing our hearts for communion now during a season of Lent, where we're waiting for the hope of Easter, it seems. During a season where we're waiting for the hope of an end to this virus. And we're overcome with our suffering, with our sin. But the good news is that that hope is there. We know Jesus Christ, the living hope, as Christians. And I got this CD in a care package from the staff of the Orchard when we lost our son Benjamin to stillbirth in 2019. This song, the first track of that CD, has been on repeat in my car ever since, for whenever I need the reminder to not lose hope, to not lose heart. So listen to the truth of these words. Make them your prayer with me as we come before the Father now.
Compared to heaven's grace.
We will not fear it. Beloved children, heirs of the Father, He is our trust. Our hope is stronger, born with the blood, sealed by the Spirit. When the storm rises, we will not fear it.
Loved ones, we are here gathered at this table to remember the Lord's death, to declare the Lord's death until He comes again in glory. He is the Lord of peace, as we learn today, and He comes and offers His peace to you and to me and welcomes you to this table in the presence of our enemies, and He protects us by His grace. And so we remember His death, we declare His victory, and we shout all the more, Hosanna, save now. In so doing, before we celebrate the Lord's Supper, I invite you to join me in declaring our faith, the faith proclaimed to all the saints, and the faith that unites us together, one in doctrine and in charity and in purity. And this is the Apostles' Creed. So I will ask the question, and you'll have the words on your screen. I'll ask the question, Orchard Christian Fellowship, what do you believe? And you will respond with the Apostles' Creed. So join me now. Orchard Christian Fellowship, what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there, He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Father, as we come to the table and remember Jesus and declare His death until He comes again, encourage us now and give us the peace that transcends all understanding. Help us all the more to know and taste His grace, to know His hope, and to be all the more together with Christ abiding in Him. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Loved ones, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, He took bread and He broke it with His disciples, saying to His disciples, "This is my body, which is broken for you. do this in remembrance of me. After having supper, he took the cup and, giving thanks, said to his disciples, "This cup is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of it, do this in remembrance of me." The Apostle Paul, as I've quoted already, the Apostle Paul says that as often as we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we declare the Lord's death until he comes again in glory. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, save now, Lord Christ. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are welcome to his table. Loved ones, let's take and eat together the body of our Lord broken for you. Loved ones, the cup of the new covenant, his blood poured out for you. Take and drink with gladness. Amen.
We're so glad that you could be with us today. We hope that this message was encouraging for you. We hope that God spoke to you. And as you leave today, it just doesn't escape me that when Jesus resurrects from the dead, you know, we're not there yet in the story, but when he resurrects, the first thing he does when he goes to his disciples is he says, "Peace be with you." The peace of Jesus Christ is full of the power of the resurrection. And that same spirit, that same peace that raised Christ from the dead lives in us. So as you go today, may you go in the peace of God through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Have a great week, guys. God bless you.